The book of Acts is the record of what happened to Jesus' followers when their universe exploded. When the Holy Spirit, this old but seemingly new embrace by God of his creation and of his creatures, all of a sudden came upon them. And their world was turned upside down. Jesus' followers were baffled by this wildness of the Spirit that couldn't be controlled. The Spirit kept going ahead of them, and they couldn't hold her fast. So the whole story tonight has these traits: upside down, wild, elusive. Now, we have a drama unfolding in these two chapters, and the readings will trace it in its slimmed down form. There's all kinds of digressions about what happened and repetition, so I tried to pick the storyline out. But the important thing is that the hero of the story is an outsider, a man by the name of Cornelius. And the writer of Acts tells us that this man feared God. And this was a technical term in early Christianity and in rabbinic Judaism at the time for Gentiles who had found their way to the God of Israel and who committed themselves to following the way of life that was set in out in the Judaism of that time. Now, the second person who figures in this story is the Apostle Peter. But he, in fact, is convinced that Jesus' mission as Messiah was only to the Jewish people. So we see the basis of a little conflict here, and we will see a resolution to it later on. So Peter and Cornelius live in separate worlds that don't understand each other. And what came to mind as I was thinking about that is the place where I've had the pleasure of living in the weeks that I've been here, and that is on 124th Street, right at the beginning of Harlem. And north of 124th Street, 9/10 of the people are black and Hispanic, and south of it, 9/10 are white. A situation, obviously, that could use some reconciling, but this sense of starkness of two different peoples, I think, serves as an illustration of the Jewish Christians and the Gentile Christians at the time when this story was being told. So God intrudes on both of these people by means of a vision. A vision, the way it's used here, is a moment in which we see something that is so clear that it's utterly convincing. And most of us wish that we had more moments like that, of course. So, at first, Cornelius is terrified when he hears an angel's voice as he goes about his affairs one day. And the angel commands him to send for a man from a faraway town called Joppa. And this man, of course, is Peter. Meanwhile, Peter in Joppa is retreating into a quiet place in his house to pray. But suddenly he has a vision as well, and that is he sees something like a sheet that is lowered from heaven filled with unclean animals. And he's told to eat them. Peter is revolted by this blatant violation of Jewish dietary law. But before he has time to make sense out of this strange happening, there's a knock on the door. And who should it be but the men that were sent by Cornelius to prevail upon Peter to go with him? Because Peter, kicking and screaming, is going to become the bridge to the world of Cornelius. And it's only on the way that Peter begins to grasp the meaning of the vision that he was given. We see this from the opening words, which we won't read, of his address to Cornelius' household, when he says, "I truly understand that God shows no partiality." So he's beginning to see that his still awkward presence in a Gentile home isn't a violation of God's intention, but a fulfillment of it. Let's hear the first part of this story.
Acts 10, 1 through 15. At Caesarea, there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion in what was known as the Italian regiment. He and all his family were devout and God-fearing. He gave generously to those in need and prayed to God regularly. One day, at about 3 in the afternoon, he had a vision. He distinctly saw an angel of God who came to him and said, "Cornelius." Cornelius stared at him in fear. "What is it, Lord?" he asked. The angel answered, "Your prayers and gifts to the poor have been come up as a memorial offering before God. Now send men to Joppa to bring back a man named Simon, who is called Peter. He is staying with Simon the tanner, whose house is by the sea." When the angel who spoke to him had gone, Cornelius called 2 of his servants and a devout soldier who was one of his attendants. He told them everything that had happened, and he sent them to Joppa. About noon the following day, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up on the roof to pray. He became hungry and wanted something to eat, and while the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He saw heaven opened and something like a large sheet being let down to earth by its 4 corners. It contained all kinds of 4-footed animals, as well as reptiles and birds. Then a voice told him, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." "Surely not, Lord," Peter said. "I have never eaten anything impure or unclean." The voice spoke to him a second time, "Do not call anything impure that God has made clean." While Peter was still thinking about the vision, the Spirit said to him, "Simon, 3 men are looking for you, so get up and go downstairs. Do not hesitate to go with them, for I have sent them." Peter went down and said to the men, "I'm the one you're looking for. Why have you come?" The men replied, "We have come from Cornelius the centurion. He is a righteous and God-fearing man who is respected by all the Jewish people. A holy angel told him to ask you to come to his house so that he could hear what you have to say."
So the next day, Peter and his guests make their way to the city of Caesarea. When Cornelius and Peter meet, it's hard to tell who is more shocked. Both of them are convinced that God is behind this encounter. And so Cornelius assembles his whole household. And then Peter's words again, "God shows no partiality." Now, while Peter is laying out his claims, the Holy Spirit falls upon everyone in the room who has a response of faith. These outsiders to the covenant begin speaking in tongues, just as Messianic Jews had done in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost. So we're left wondering who's more amazed among these people. When he gains his composure, Peter cries out, "How can we withhold baptism from these people?" The next reading.
Acts 10:44-48. "Our ancestors had the tent of testimony in the wilderness, as God directed when he spoke to Moses, ordering them to make it according to the pattern he had seen. Our ancestors, in turn, brought it in with Joshua when they dispossessed the nations that God drove out before our ancestors. And it was there until the time of David, who found favor with God and asked that he might find a dwelling place for the house of Jacob. But it was Solomon who built a house for Yet the Most High does not dwell in houses made with human hands, as the prophet says.
So we have the next episode in this uncanny tale. Peter retells his astonishing encounter to his fellow believers in Jerusalem. And the first thing they do is scold him because he was breaking bread with outsiders to the covenant. And in response, Peter recites to these leaders the highlights of his encounter with Cornelius. The vision about the sheet and the unclean things, the ominous knock on the door, the journey to a far place, and the great reception that he got there. He then asks what is really a rhetorical question in his mind at this point. If then God gave these people the same that he gave, gift that he gave us when we first believed, who was I that I could hinder God? At first, the Jerusalemites are shocked into silence. This is so new, so contrary. But by the end of the conversation, they also praise God. The next reading.
So this reading is from Acts 11, 1 through 4, the first part of 4, and then 17 and 18. And it says, "Now the apostles and the believers who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also accepted the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him, saying, 'Why did you go to uncircumcised men and eat with them?' Then Peter began to explain it to them step by step. He said, If then God gave them the same gift that he gave us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could hinder God?' When they heard this, they were silenced, and they praised God, saying, 'Then God has given even to the Gentiles the repentance that leads to life.'"
So now we've heard this story, and the question, of course, is how do we apply it to our lives? First of all, this is a tale of two conversions. The obvious one is that of Cornelius. We are let in on this secret friendship that God already has with Cornelius before Peter ever gets there. But Peter also needed to be converted because he couldn't imagine that God had opened the covenant with Israel to people beyond Israel. The revolution in Peter's ministry happens when he realizes that Cornelius is not an outsider to whom he could be indifferent, but someone in whom God's Spirit is already at home. He learns that nobody God has created is unclean or beyond the call of God's grace. So a true witness happens when both the seeker and the witness are changed by meeting each other. So the church is not them becoming more like us, if we think of ourselves as the insiders, but both of us helping one another become more like Christ. Now, as I was preparing my sermon, I heard Cornelius and Peter's adventures as if for the first time, and their excitement was contagious. God is at home in the hearts of everyone who will listen to him. Witnessing to Christ is not a matter of trying to talk someone into something. Rather, it is being ready for a moment of truth when we have the privilege of naming the stirrings in someone's heart. Now, when I went on to imagine myself as a participant in this story, I became troubled. And I wondered why I was suddenly troubled. And I came up with three reasons, and I want to share them with you, and perhaps you'll identify with one or the other of them, and then try to respond to the questions that are asked. The first thing that concerned me was that the words of the church's witness are often hollow. Too much talk about God trivializes God. How on earth can we say something new about Jesus in a country like this one that people won't have heard 100 times in church or on religious radio? Second question. Attempts to persuade someone of my truth seem disrespectful to people of another or of no religion. People with whom we work and live every day. Shouldn't we respect people who are different from ourselves and not suspect them until they become like us? Third, even when we're willing to confess Jesus, words that seem authentic often seem to evade us. And so we long for an inspiration like Peter's, where the Spirit was so close that Peter could sense that Cornelius was ready to hear a word that he was already seeking. Okay, let me try to address these three questions. First of all, what about the question of hollow witnessing? In our society, religion is advertised like cars and appliances. And those of us who have grown up in the church know its and our own frequent lapses into self-righteousness and hypocrisy. And we squirm at calls to evangelize that seem triumphalistic and condescending and a whole long list of things. We feel that the least we could do in claiming integrity as Christians is to keep our mouths shut. And surely, there are times when silence is the truest witness. Now, Mennonites are good at knowing that our witness to the gospel begins with how we live before we talk. In fact, most of the Christian life consists of patient and persistent love towards anyone who comes across our path. But if we follow Peter and Cornelius' encounter, there are times when the Spirit prepares someone in our life to hear in words the reason for the hope that is in us. And if we remain sensitive to the stirrings of the Spirit, we will gradually get to know the times when words matter. And if we always remain silent, don't we give the impression that our goodness is going to point people to God? That that's sufficient. And you might remember what I said last Sunday, that the liberating message of the New Testament is not that we love others because we're good. We love them because we're loved. Number two, when naming Jesus seems disrespectful to people of other beliefs, well, nowhere better in New York do we encounter this reality. It's a tough question. My response at this point in my life is that there is a tension here between two truths, and we can't let go of either of them. On the one hand, God's Spirit stirs in all people. And so we should look for stirrings of the Spirit in people of other religions, in their prayers, in their love for justice and mercy. And only God is there and our final judge. But that still leaves the role of a witness. If, like Peter and Cornelius, the Holy Spirit has shown us Christ as a living presence in our lives, we can't help being a witness of that. So how can we hold on to this tension in life-giving ways? I have seen the Spirit at work in calling a Jewish man that some of you likely know into faith in Christ. His name was Eliezer, and once he took me aside, he was ready to tell me his story of faith after a long time when I didn't know much about him. He told me that he had been a secular Jew with no interest in religion. One day he was in the hospital recuperating from a cancer operation, and he saw Jesus standing at the foot of his bed, radiating love and saying, "I want you to follow me." And Eliezer said the aura around Jesus was just irresistible. Now, it's important to note that this man coming to Jesus as Messiah did not turn his back on Judaism and God's covenant with the Jews, but he did develop a willingness when he sensed someone seeking something more than they had found to be willing to talk about how he had met Jesus. So I think that if we hold on to this tension, we will honor the faith of others while still being willing to be a sign by our deeds, first of all, our silences, second of all, but third, our words, so that people who are at the point of seeking Christ can meet him. Now, I would say the more urgent concern of the church is not people of other religions, but the vast majority of our culture of people who have no living faith, no living community. So when we see them love mercy and do justice, we should make common cause with them, even if our beliefs are quite different. When we see them broken by injustices and alone in the world or seduced by things that can't satisfy, we should risk pointing them not to ourselves, but beyond ourselves to the one who, in whom all things hold together. It's not ourselves that we proclaim, but the one whom death could not hold. Finally, response to the third question about being troubled by Peter and Cornelius' story, that is, when words such as Peter finally found simply don't come to us. I've brooded over this many, many times. I think sometimes we have nothing to say because we become preoccupied with worldly cares, and so we're not sensitive to the nudgings of the Spirit. But there are also times when sincere people seek adequate words to name their faith, and it's as if the Spirit is obscured and too far away. I suppose I would say that in a broken world, God is obscured from us. And when times like this happen, I think we believe on each other's behalf, like the four friends who took the man on a pallet and lowered him down to Jesus. It was their faith that brought him to Jesus. So I'm almost done. I long to share the excitement of Peter and Cornelius when God turned their world upside down. And people were waiting for someone to tell them what this meant. There are no pet formulas for this kind of thing, and there are no clever tactics that we can resort to. That's been the problem of so much Christian witness. But I think being willing to be a sign of Christ calls for a way of living that listens for the promptings of the Spirit, either directly or through another person. As we listen for the Spirit, let us remember that there are times for deeds, times for silences, and also times for words. And let us remember that there are many Corneliuses or Cornelias in the world, women and men in whom God's Spirit is at work, looking for a sign as to where they should turn next. So, how will I respond? How will you respond the next time the Spirit says to us what she said to Peter? Look, these people are searching for you. Go down and go with them, because I have sent them. Will we turn back in fear, or will we take the risk? Amen.